That's a great idea, Teresa. Get that to me by the end of play today and action it ASAP. Hello again. Now, let's take a look at the history of the IT department at Renham Industries. From our humble beginnings when everyone hated us, to our recent abrupt and unconvincing rise to power. It's a story for the ages. Let's look at it now.
The IT crowd first booted up and onto our screens in 2006. And since then, there have been four series and most recently, a one-hour special.
Probably my favourite sitcom, I would say. Actually, yes.
Let's get started, shall we?
What? The show centres on the adventures of four magnificently silly characters. Three hapless employees of Renham Industries, Roy, Moss,
I am a giddy goat,
Jen, and their boss, Douglas.
God! Damn these electric sex pants!
No one really knows what Renham Industries does, but whatever it is, they need an efficient and responsive IT department.
Get out of the lift. Get out of the lift.
We were like these kind of fictional creatures, kind of abandoned to a nether region of cobwebs and second toilets.
Oh my god!
Like all good sitcoms, it's a bunch of outsiders against the world, which I think is appealing.
Creator and writer Graham Linehan brought to life a classic sitcom about a corporate world where nothing works, least of all the IT department, and which celebrated the heroic misadventures of what the show called standard nerds.
Often they're incredibly intelligent people who have to do these really boring jobs that are just beneath them. And I thought that that was a nice way of starting.
Graham, you know, is a very warm, great comic, you know, writer. He came up with the idea, injected the warmth. It's big because of him.
The sparkling scripts were brought to life by some of Britain's most brilliant and inventive comic actors. Richard Iowadi, Catherine Parkinson, Chris O'Dowd, Matt Berry, Noel Fielding, and Chris Morris.
The writer of Father Ted and Chris Morris was going to be in it, so, you know, I was really excited. It was a real gift, you know.
This multi-award-winning comedy has won fans around the world. The geeks really have inherited the earth.
Excuse me.
Yes, miss.
The elements of slapstick and broad physical humour and visual gags and references, all these things make it very accessible.
At the heart of the IT crowd is Maurice Moss, who is supposedly the brains of the IT department.
I guess Moss is very childlike and very positive, I'd say.
Well, I think that Moss is a classic square. You know, he's a nerd, a timeless nerd.
Oh, oh dear me.
What are you laughing at?
This flipping circuit board, Jen. Some chump has run the data lines right through the power supply. Amateur hour. I've got tears in my eyes.
It's a very broad character, you know. He's got his hairstyle, he's got his clothes.
Oh, I just had a eureka moment.
And yet, there's something very authentic about his portrayal.
Why do I keep my phone in my trouser pocket? It's too far, but look at this. Top pocket. Yeah? Yeah? Black. See how smooth that is? Ooh, mama.
The thing about Moss was he was just a big amalgam of various different, I guess, stereotypes and also little bits of uniqueness that were brought to it by me and Richard. And they all just kind of morphed together.
Your name is Maurice Moss, is it not?
Sorry. Bit nervous, so, yeah.
It's fizzy, it's very fizzy. It's fizzy, it's gone fizzy. Ow, come on! That's electric. There's electric in there. What a shock.
Well, Richard is, despite appearances, a very bright guy and very, very precise and incredibly funny. Like, just so dry. And the fact that he plays such an uncool character is one of my favourite things in the world, because he's one of the coolest people I know.
The character was occasionally able to adopt a more confident persona, like a child imitating a cowboy or something, but then would just drop it and it wouldn't particularly continue.
Roy, can I have a natter with you? It's about Private Man's business. I'm sure you boys will understand.
Yeah.
Excuse me, please.
Richard loves playing overconfident people, and it was nice to be able to give him a chance to do that every now and again.
Will I see you tonight?
Not now, Ivana.
Did you have sex with that lady?
If you call that mindless, animalistic, rutting sex, then yes. I suppose we did.
He's like one of my best friends, actually, so I love watching him perform. Just got that weird voice, hasn't he? That's amazing. All right, now. He sort of always sounds like Graham Coxon to me. Oh, no, I've can't tie my shoelaces up.
Apparently, he remembers me doing this, but I don't remember doing it. I said, yeah, I just see a really, really nerdy guy, just very, very kind of geeky and nerdy, you know, and focused on things that aren't important and stuff. And he said, oh, yeah, what kind of voice should I put on? And I said, oh, no, just your normal voice. So, you know, but I think really what I meant when I said that was I just wanted Richard.
He was a bit of a grower for me, actually, in the IT crowd. And, yeah, I wish he'd do a bit more performing, actually.
What do you say, newbie?
I came here to drink milk and kick ass. And I've just finished my milk.
Moss's friend and colleague in the IT department is Roy Trenneman, Renham Industries' resident shambles of a man.
He was slightly more capable of talking to people from the outside world than Moss was. But essentially he was that man-child, that slightly kind of socially inept.
There's a lack of self-awareness maybe in Roy, and that he thinks he's cooler than that. I mean, he thinks he's on the cool edge of nerdiness, I think, you know.
The first thing I thought was very important was that Roy shouldn't be played by an Irish person. And then Chris came in and he was just amazing and you know, and I thought, well, I'll actually be brought up against the race relations board if I don't hire Chris, because he's obviously the best man for the job.
I remember in the first series really enjoying Roy in Messy Joe's and he was just trying so hard to be a bastard because that's what he thought that women wanted to go out with.
This seems an unusual place for someone like you to want to meet.
Yeah, well, everyone needs a place to come to be alone.
His absolute snark and misanthropy is really bang on for a certain tribe of nerds. He is YouTube commenter number 3 who says, no, it's just shit.
No, Jen, it's infected. If this was a human being, I'd shoot it in the face.
I like the Fire in the Sea Parks. I think that's one of my favourite storylines for him.
Her parents died in a fire.
Oh, God, I'm sorry, that's horrible.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it was a fire. At Sea Parks.
Sea Parks?
Yeah.
It just seems like a weird place to go on fire.
It's a very weird place to go on fire! A fire at a sea park? It's the weirdest thing I've ever heard!
That's probably one of the ones I get quoted most is... A fire? In a sea park? That was actually one of the most fun things to do on the day, I remember. It's just so... Just the incredulousness of it.
He cannot rest. He literally cannot sleep until he's worked out how a fire could have happened at Sea Parks.
There are 12 exits.
What are you doing?
What?
What are you doing on the computer?
Masturbating.
And he works it out. And his emotions at that moment are pure satisfaction that he has solved a problem.
I see. So if the fire started here and they were there, then there's no way they could have escaped. So they must have been there.
We just catch. Stop it.
Chris is a very good actor, so he's able to actually imbue things with emotion rather than just choose what level of nasal to do.
Hello? Hello? You all right in there? Do you need help?
I'm disabled.
I do love people, though, who, instead of just accepting that maybe I better stop this because this might get a bit embarrassing, will actually go the full way and lie down on the toilet floor and pretend to be disabled.
Oh, my God, what happened? I fell off the toilet.
For me, that's a certain kind of bravery. There's a certain kind of bravery in that I kind of admire.
How are you disabled?
Leg disabled.
Oh, wait, I'm being... Do you have a wheelchair?
Yes.
Where?
Stolen.
What comes across very obviously at the sort of core, and that warm core, is Chris's sort of natural warmth.
Chris O'Dowd is just, he's just got funny bones.
Oh, thanks again, man. This really does feel so much better. Oh.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
There we are. All finished. Mwah.
Roy and Moss have a very special relationship. Despite their occasional ups and downs, they make the perfect couple.
I think that what's really developed over the series is the relationship between Roy and Moss. They're sort of like the couple.
It's such a lovely day. Shall we go to the park?
Yeah, let's have a lovely lunch in the park.
I always thought that they met each other at college on the first day, and then they never met anybody else. And that was it. They maybe lived together and would stay up playing games. And they just never got laid.
Ooh, what have we here?
Hello.
So, tell me, who wears the trousers in this relationship?
What? No, we're not homosexuals. We're just very good friends.
So you never had a look?
At what?
His bum!
I've seen it when he crosses in front of my desk, or should he bend over to pick something up?
I'd love to work in that office.
Yeah, they are basically, they are like two 14-year-olds who've suddenly discovered a best friend in the other person. But, you want people who seem like friends, you know? If they didn't, you wouldn't want to spend time with them.
Let's glare.
What?
Let's glare at people like a couple of tough nuts.
Oh, okay.
Let's glare at this sucker on his way to work. Yeah, feeding the corporate machine. He's coming.
He's coming on the bus. Oh, God. I should suggest him. You can suggest anybody.
What are you doing?
We weren't. We thought you were someone else.
What's it to you?
Sorry, we're bunking off and he's excited.
We're bunking off!
It reminds me a little bit of Steptoe and Son, because one drags the other down, and Chris Roy seems like a sort of he's frustrated, wants to break out of this sort of dynamic, but can't, and ultimately is as dependent on Moss as Moss is on him.
Jen should never have ended up in the basement. She knows nothing about computers and has no interest in learning because she's better than IT. She's going places.
I think Catherine Parkinson is amazing in her role because Graham has created a woman that I recognise in real life.
One of the first things we auditioned was the interview about what she knows about computers, and, you know, she was doing all that mouses, all that stuff beautifully. So, you know, she was really funny.
I'm going to put you in IT. Because you said on your CV you have a lot of experience with computers.
I did say that on my CV, yes.
I have a lot of experience with the whole computer thing, you know, emails, sending emails, receiving emails, deleting emails.
The ordinary person up against this sort of the Leviathan of 20th century technology.
Clicking, double-clicking. The computer screen, of course.
Which goes back to Chaplin's Modern Times and Jacques Tati's Mon Oncle.
I don't know whether it's necessarily that she's a likeable character. I think it's more that there is that shallow, vain, egotistic aspect to all of us.
Is this a new desk?
Yeah, I thought I needed some new furniture, so I got some stuff from upstairs. Sit down, please.
I think as the series went on, obviously, Jen became more of a part of the trio rather than being an adversary kind of figure. And she became more and more socially inept.
The best thing about the job was meeting Catherine for the first time, you know, and kind of working with Catherine because, you know, I hadn't, you know, never sort of worked with her before. And, you know, I thought she was great. You know, I'd always want to do stuff, you know, with her again.
Goodness me. What would you term what just happened there?
Norman says my voice is extraordinary.
He's right. Oh. This is a long song.
In her love life, she's as disastrous as the rest of womankind, it seems to me.
Let me guess. You're a red wine person.
Yes, yes I am.
Oh, I would be too if we could get some service round here. Yeah, you, Hucknall. when you're simply ready.
There's the brilliant episode with Adam Buxton where he thinks she's died and then goes around telling everyone in the office that she was the last person. He was the last person she'd had sex with.
I'm a bit stressed. Is all and just fun and games.
I think the moment of her in the rain, you know, at the window, that's exactly what I wanted it to be. You know, the haunting of Bill Krause. It's exactly how I saw it. Fit that shape, you know.
Tell me, baby, I'm set with you.
Despite being technically superior to everyone else at Renham Industries and ensuring that the computers keep ticking along, Moss, Roy and Jen are always treated as the social underclass.
The brilliant thing he did was create a world, a kind of enclosed world, a bubble, really, for these characters to function in where absolutely insane things can happen.
I know that the place looks like a bit of a mess, but it's actually a very delicate ecosystem. Everything is connected. It's like the rainforest.
The rain.
You change one thing, even the tiniest bit, and the whole rainforest dies.
I had a brother who was working in IT, still works in IT. So I kind of knew that world a little bit and how socially inept he and his friends were and just the grumpiness of that situation.
The things that Roy's are being asked to do are so beneath his capabilities that he's started to hate people.
And it's not them, it's definitely me phoning them up. I'm the annoying one that can't do the simple thing. You can totally see why they would be, you know, a little bit angry sometimes.
Hello, IT. Have you tried turning it off and on again?
You know what? I'm sick of saying that.
It's kind of lasting legacy for me will be its technical advice, which is basically turn it off, turn it on again. That's the legacy of the IT crowd for me.
The button turns it on. Yeah. You do know how a button works, don't you?
The button. No, the button. No, not my shirt button.
No, there you go. No, there you go. I just heard it come on. No, that's the music you hear when it comes on. No, that's the music you hear when... I'm sorry, are you from the past?
Are you from the past? I mean, it is so absolutely wonderful. It really is. I want it on a sampler over my bed.
Up on the boss level, Renham Industries has been tormented by two different bosses. Firstly, by the demented and deranged Denham.
I am declaring war. I can see that got your attention.
I thought the casting of Chris Morris, absolute genius, because he was so just incredibly excited to see Chris Morris entering into the spirit of this completely extraordinarily over-the-top character.
He brings this this slightly terrifying edge, very strict. You don't want to get on his wrong side.
You fucked up.
And slightly sociopathic sort of performance.
Take this balloon, Jen. I'm gonna burst it, but I'm not gonna tell you when. Do you feel stressed, Jen? Jen, look at that. That's your peace of mind. It's gonna go bang.
I'd never met him and was terrified. Was a big fan, like everybody. And he just couldn't have been more welcoming and fun. I had a great time with him. I was mostly reacting to kind of mad stuff that he was doing because his character was kind of like that, which I was happy about because I wouldn't have been comfortable trying to make him laugh.
Chris really had that authority that I was looking for, which I loved so much in his day-to-day and Brass Eye persona.
He set the tone brilliantly in the first series because there's a way of doing Graham's material that isn't, you can't just be realistic with it. That's not really what's required.
Sorry to interrupt, but there are some policemen here. They say they need to speak to you about irregularities in the pension fund.
I see. Could you make him a cup of tea, please, Stephanie?
His suicide is, for me, one of the best moments in all of the series.
Following his abrupt resignation, Douglas, his even more bonkers son, arrives with an even bigger ego and a rampant libido.
Father!
I think Douglas had possibly the best introduction to a comedy character I've ever seen.
Priest, where is your God? Where is your God now? Here lies a great man. A great man! Father!
Matt Berry sort of took it on a notch, I think, really, from Chris Morris. He really, you know, nailed it, you know, with his daft voice.
It's a tall order, you know, filling his boots. So I was pretty keen just to go in, you know, and sort of do my own thing. And if it worked, it did. If it didn't, you know, they'd let me know pretty quick.
I think Douglas is a complete tool.
What department is this?
Sorry?
Well, if it's work-related, then obviously you'll know what department this is. What department is this?
Some sort of homosexual department. He had to be so confident and so sort of privileged that he didn't care whether things, you know, would come out wrong, whether they'd cause, offence, or, you know, make him look like a fool, because that would be, you know, impossible for him.
It's all the worst qualities you can give a man. Sex mad, well, that's not too bad, I suppose. Misogynist, mean, vain, and bullying.
The episode where he does end up dating the journalist who comes to interview him is astonishing.
Favourite popular figure?
Churchill.
Wow, what is it you like about him?
I love the way he says, "Ah, oh, yes." Ah, oh, yes.
The story is that this woman ends up being a person who's had a man who's had a sex change.
April, I love you.
What?
That's right. I totally love the bloody ass off you.
And the best thing is, before he makes this realization, it's the perfect relationship because they're watching the darts in bed, they're eating takeaway, they're, you know, having competitions so you can down the fastest pint and then going home and shagging each other. It really is the perfect relationship for Douglas until, of course, he realises exactly what's going on.
Oh, Poppet. To think when we met, you were so worried that you came from Iran.
A and almost like the joy of it is it's so ridiculous that he misheard that in such a pathetic way.
A man! I said I used to be a man!
You used to be a man.
Yes!
Oh, God!
Roy, Moss and Jen aren't alone in the basement. Behind the mysterious red door lives Richmond.
It just shows how brilliant Graham's writing is to get a character who's... You can have a kind of Edward Scissorhands weirdo in the middle of an IT department, and it works completely.
First thing I ever did was she opened the door and I was there, and it was sort of like... It was a great thing, it was a great reveal.
He's just in his own happy world, hiding in his server room. I assume that's what it's supposed to be, and he doesn't know what the blinking lights do.
I mean, I don't know what any of this stuff even does. What's going on there? I don't know. Is it good that it's doing that? Occasionally it doesn't do that, and I think I should tell them, but often I just look away.
Jen and Catherine have soft spots for Richmond.
Richmond.
He's so sweet and vulnerable.
Why is he out of his room?
Well, he's going to come out and play with us for a while.
I think she was supposed to find me a bit horrendous, but she always found me quite... She's always quite motherly to me. I was sort of quite like Richmond. They had a bit of chemistry, which they wasn't supposed to have at all.
To me, he seems like a sort of damaged bird that needs to be looked after, and he's sort of too vulnerable for this world, really. Noel isn't like that, but Richmond is.
Noel would come in like, a pink cowboy hat and, like, studded boots. Make us feel like we were at a rock concert. Walking around before he got into costume or whatever. Made, like, the denim offices downstairs feel like we were backstage at the O2. With the darkness.
Richmond! Get back to your room!
Oh, I'd watch Noel play darts. I think he's just fantastic.
Noel's character, that, you know, his voice is fantastic. I think it's the funniest voice I've ever heard Noel do. I wish he talked like that the whole time.
I'd had an idea because I watched the Pink Floyd documentary and I was fascinated by how posh they were. And I just sort of...
So I sort of had that kind of voice and it's quite soft and sort of thought it would be quite funny for a goth to be quite sort of... posh, because they're never really...
They're not Cockneys, are they ever, goths? They're always
sort of quite softly spoken in English, almost sort of ghostly character.
Like he could blow away in the wind.
You know, when you laugh, I can see the outline of your skull. You have a beautiful skull.
For someone who's so... always looks like Ronnie Wood, he is very brilliant at doing lots of different characters and voices.
I keep getting typecast, actually, as vampires, goths. Vampires, goths, ghosts, ghouls, monsters. I've cornered that market. Oh, yeah, like a sort of substandard Johnny Depp.
Oh, Richmond. Oh, Richmond, not you too. I'm sorry, Richmond, I just get bitten bad.
There's one more unique element of the show we haven't mentioned. The studio set is a character all of its own.
I'll always love this set because it's so, you know, it really ended up looking, well, not ended up, our very fine production design team made it look like I wanted it to, you know. It looks like the inside of my head. It looks like the inside of my office as well, a little bit. It's the same kind of cheerful mess.
How can you two live like this?
How can you two...
Don't Google the question, Moss!
A lot of the things on the walls, not all of them, but many of the things on the walls are sent in by people. This is a fanzine that I like, that the guy sent in. He was delighted when we ended up using it for some of the publicity shots. A lot of the stuff up here is just stuff that I'm a fan of. There's some things here that I didn't ask for, or I didn't plan, and they just kind of, They just kind of came, like this wonderful collection here of old Atari games, which is just a lovely little touch. In the drawer here is Douglas's electric sex pants.
Free at last. I could get to like these. Just the job. Good work.
We always associated Roy with more with music and, you know, this kind of underground art. And over on Moss's side, we associated him with the hardware, you know. All the stuff that was donated to us by the Centre for Computer History in Cambridge. And this is the kind of thing that whenever I would share a photograph online, people would say, they've got a pet, they've got a pet. Or they've got, what else have they got? They've got an Altair. This drives nerds mental. They get very excited about this. I think this is pretty good too, an Oric. And there's the one I had when I was a kid, a Spectrum, a ZX Spectrum. Board games. Now this is something that, because of the last episode, people might think that I was slagging off board gamers, but I'm actually a huge board games fan, and it was all done from a position of affection.
I've been looking at the expansion to Textile Merchant. Textile Merchant, Norfolk Edition.
Two games by Rainer Konitsky. Hold on to your hat. It's going to be a bumpy...
That was a request by Richard. Richard's a big fan of the band Pivot. I like them too. But I hadn't thought of getting them in the show until he said it. Oh yeah, over here we have some classic Dungeons & Dragons style figures. These are the actual metal ones. These are the hand-painted lead figures that I used to play with when I was a kid. The thing about role-playing games is that, you know, they're about storytelling. So, you know, it was just, when I was a kid, it was just one more way to tell stories.
Yes! Direct hit. The knife cleaves his head in twain, and some of his brains runneth down John 2's invisibility cloak.
Eiffel Tower!
And into Jen's office. This is of course, the internet from the speech episode.
What is it?
This, Jen, is the internet.
To be honest with you, it's a joke I wish I'd done more, which is Jen's misunderstanding or lack of interest or confusion when it comes to the internet, meeting the boys' kind of sense of, you know, divilment.
Oh, no, Jen, no. This needs to go straight back to Big Ben.
Big Ben?
Yeah, it goes on top of Big Ben. That's where you get the best reception.
I promise, I won't let anything happen to it.
No, Jen, I'm sorry. But the elders of the internet would never stand for
it. It was a really nice little episode. I'm really glad. It's one of the ones I'm proudest of.
So, can I have it?
You can.
Oh, don't forget your speech.
Oh, thank you.
Shh.
Definitely ended up being the kind of place that not only would I, you know, did I like seeing it on screen, I would actually like to work here, you know. Oh, right, it's not real.
It was on this set that the studio audience watched our heroes and their disasters unfold during each weekly live recording.
Every week we were rehearsing, and then we'd put it in front of an audience on Friday night. And the actors, they can't help it. They see the audience as a theatre audience, and it's going to be a show that they can do once for this audience. So it's very, very, it's very nerve-wracking. It's one of the reasons I like it, because it makes us all work harder. There's a rigor in a studio audience record. It really focuses your mind. You know, you come up with better jokes, the beats are clearer, because everybody is worried about that Friday night.
It's incredibly jangly on the nerves. The day is very long. It starts at about 7 in the morning, but you're not recording till about 8 p.m., and then it doesn't finish till about 11. So by the end, you're really deranged. And I keep wondering whether it would be a completely different show if everyone wasn't so tired. I think people's extreme exhaustion is the house style.
Stuff that isn't shot in front of an audience is just a case of a very quiet room. And someone saying go, then you go, then they say stop, and you stop, and that's it. You know, and then you spend, you know, the rest of the day listening to another actor go, I don't know whether I was any good there, you know, I don't know what I'd... You know what I mean? Whereas this, you know straight away, because, you know, they let you know.
In the past, I have found it a bit... I've felt a bit threatened by and sort of got a bit nervous about the studio audience, but over the series, I've really begun to embrace it and really enjoy it.
That was all getting a little bit... Keep rolling, yeah?
It's a great experience in timing and, you know, kind of various things. I mean, I really like it.
I think it's just a real buzz. It's quite scary, but I think that makes everyone better. It sort of forces you into a position where you've got to be good and tight.
It works very well in that environment, and maybe because they probably are all very comfortable with each other and know that they're going to work well with each other, then that does help if you're recording in front of an audience.
A bonus for the audience was the regular cameo appearances by well-known British comedy faces.
Hello.
Kevin's character is based on me dealing with the help desk for my PC, which was, they'd always be French, and they'd always have an incredibly thick accent. So I'd be lying on the floor looking at a completely indecipherable mess of wires with this guy going, have you buzzed Ford? And have I what, sorry? Have you buzzed the Ford? Have you buzzed the Ford?
Can I buy this?
So we started going through the scene, we did a take, and he was just pressing through from the control booth, and he said, more French, more silly. And I said, look, I said, you know, Graham, I said, you know, I've spent months perfecting a lower middle class Dijon accent. And he said, well, that was a waste of time. Now do it more French and more silly.
I've got one of your laptops. It won't get past the loading screen.
Have you turned it on again?
Yes, look, is there someone else I can talk to?
There is no one available.
In the end, I was getting really upset. I was saying, you know, I said, Graham, I said, you know, you're asking me to compromise artistic truth and reality for a cheap joke. And his answer to that was,
it's Zubion, I think.
Oh, Zubion, you have to say, we have been having problems with Zubion. Can you please interrupt me?
I didn't get that.
And in the end, he seemed satisfied. It took 9 hours, and I left the studio a broken man. But I've looked back at it since then, and I've realised that Graham was exactly right. And my only criticism would be that it should have actually been more French and more silly.
Hello.
The IT Crowd won numerous awards and the stars of the show have gone global. But they all came back to the basement one last time to make the brilliant and apparently final special episode.
Big films, directing, theatrical, all these major kind of milestones in their careers. And they come back to Renham Industries.
Come on, who are we? Who are we? I want to hear you say it.
We're the IT department
of
Renham Industries.
Goddamn right we are.
It's a testament to the show, isn't it, that that everyone came back for it, for one last job, just when they thought they were out. Graham pulled them right back in.
I had the script ready, and we kept looking for this window to do it in, and suddenly I was told we have a two-week window to do it.
It was really good. It felt good. I was delighted that we got the opportunity to do one last one. And I think it was a great way to show how brutal the aging process is and has been to all of us, and that even people on TV can't escape Mother Nature.
It feels odd because you suddenly get back in the room together and it is like no time has passed whatsoever. But there's something very nice about that.
I realised it was happening and I think I maybe just tweeted him and said, oh, I am around because I'm writing. So if you do want me to do anything, like a little cameo or something. And then he phoned me. I was like, yeah, that'll be great. And I was like, okay.
It was good. It was, I mean, you know, it's just, you just put on, you know, a three-piece suit and, you know, be a huge dick. And, That's all it is. It's as simple as that.
Well, with this special, one of the things he wanted to do with the writing was to give everyone their own story, which they had.
You just sold a brother some slacks.
And also to try and hark back and just have a few pointers reminding people of the series.
I'm such an idiot. I've got a robot hand!
It felt like Graham was taking an opportunity to have some, say some things about the current situation with social media, with Twitter, with, you know, YouTube and all of that, and the kind of hysteria that surrounds people saying or doing the wrong thing, in heavy quotes.
It's being called the viral video of the year. A woman throws a coffee onto a tramp, and then a man has an argument with a small barista.
You're just too small!
The barista goes to cross the road and is hit by a van with breasts.
That kind of that mob mentality on the internet where people see something and judge immediately on that, and this huge pitchforks or twitch forks or chitch forks, as I suppose it would be in Graham's world, being raised, and poor Jen and Roy having to sit there and wade through it all.
We thought, how can we best show that this has gone viral rather than just saying it? So Graham had the great idea of just sort of asking fans or anyone out there if they'd want to take a photo of themselves in front of a monument that was recognisable, looking horror-struck at having seen the video of Jen throwing coffee over the poor homeless woman.
As the identities of coffee-tossed tramp bitch and small-person racist are finally revealed, we at Channel 4 News ask, what the hell is wrong with people?
I like the fans being involved in that way, especially when it makes sense in a kind of story way.
And we had, 200-300 of these photos came in, and it was terrific. So you'll see on there everything from, there are two Daily Telegraph journalists outside the Real Number 10, a lady in Tiananmen Square. There were also a couple who must have hopped over the hedge into the grounds of Craggy Island House, where Father Ted was set. So for those who want to, you know, stop frame it and have a look, you'll find some very special photos there.
I loved the special. I thought it was a brilliant balance of callbacks and fantastic new material.
Let's hide it!
What?
The internet!
Oh. Because we told you that that was the internet.
I think my favourite bit in the whole special actually was Moss getting in the phone box and taking his trousers off.
I'd like to know how many men around the UK slipped on a pair of women's slacks, just to test the confidence theory.
Thank you.
What was quite nice is when we came back and I put the costume on from the original, from the first series. I was quite glad I fitted into it, actually. A little fatter, but I could just about squeeze into it.
We hit upon the different thing of him just appearing behind Jen's shoulder in her office, and that was really funny. And then we got him to help us. We wanted just him to glide him out of it, and we thought of all sorts of things. And in the end, I said, why don't we just put him on a little skate, which is just a board with some wheels on it, the simplest old-fashioned way of doing it.
Don't look! Where did he go?
Where did who go?
It was quite nice, actually, doing that, and it was nice doing it in front of an audience again. Yeah, it was quite nice. That night was really nice, actually. I was so glad to be involved.
You know, I think last episodes of great shows that have huge followings, there's a certain amount of pressure because the fans want to feel that it's a cap, it's a final kind of comment on the whole history of the show in a way. They want to feel a certain amount of resolution. They want to feel that it feels like a final episode, and this one did.
Is what's happening good now? Is this good?
Yes, it's a very good outcome. Oh my God, I think we've come out on top. I can't believe it. We've come out on top.
Because Richard was the person who I built the show around, so it made absolute sense that he should be the person who turns out the light, you know?
In a way, I'm delighted that they made it out the basement. In another way, when Moz turned out the basement light for the final time, I felt my heart fracture.
There aren't that many episodes of the ITV crowd that are trying to be moving in any way, and I think it would be awful if they did, but this one just had the right amount of sentimentality and sweetness at the end. Yeah, brilliant.
In some ways, it's just a normal IT crowd episode, but it's nice to take them for one last spin.
Weirdly, it felt like things had come around
And actually, this show would work perfectly if it were to start now, because all of that stuff is so huge. You can have loads of Twitter stuff and loads of Facebook stuff. And it actually is, the world has come around to fit perfectly into what Graham's vision of the show was in the first place, I think.
But I feel that what was most beguiling about the IT Crowd was that at its core is a real warmth between the characters. They are actually quite supportive of each other. And I think that's what sort of makes it stand out, really. I think it's a real shame that they're not doing any more.
What are they up to now, the characters? What are they up to now?
I think they'll be down in that basement. They will have made such a hash of running anything. Douglas will have suddenly found, you know, the top price lawyer to get him out of any problem. He'll have a new suit and he'll be back in his place, and you can bet your life they'll still be there.
I imagine he'll do the exact same thing for a long time, and would be very happy doing that.
She needs to grow up. She needs to pack in Renham Industries. She's not suited to it. Stop wearing the suits and the heels. She can't even walk in heels. She looks like a prat in heels.
He'll be dead. Yeah, he'll be dead in a light aircraft. It'll be like, what's his face, John Denver. He'll go that way. He'll go in his own aircraft, that he'll be arrogant enough to think he doesn't need anyone else to, you know, sort of pilot it with him. And he'll go straight into a canyon. I hope.
I like the idea of going back and doing the show in 10 years' time. And Jen and I will be married and divorced. And Moss and I will be living above Matt Berry's house in the Hamptons. So all of us, just happy. Finally.
Favourite episodes are coming up. Yours, as in The Fans, is next, and then Mr. Linehan's choice straight after. Now, what if you and Graham voted for the same one? That'll be the same episode back to... Have we thought this through?